I don't think an ecosystem per se has any value. It's not a subject of experience. What does have intrinsic value are the subjects of experience within it. And unfortunately, most of us being brought up on wildlife documentaries have a very romanticized view about what nature and ecosystems involve, but essentially it is creatures eating each other a lot of the time, and starvation, parasitism, disease is endemic to nature and the living world. Most contemporaries associate nature with beautiful experiences. If you are starving or watching your offspring being eaten by a predator or being consumed by parasites or coming to a very nasty sticky end, as most human animals do, then your perspective on what nature is all about is clearly going to be very different. So, should we aim to, very crudely speaking, destroy nature, simply preserving whatever is nature for maximal human flourishing? Not necessarily, in the sense it's possible to preserve a recognisable approximation of nature as it exists today, or certainly the charismatic megafauna that loom large in our imagination, while phasing out the nastiness of nature. Essentially, this will involve in our future wildlife parks fertility regulation, such that there aren't population explosions followed by complete ecological collapse, tweaking the carnivorous predators so they're no longer molesting the herbivores, and essentially a kind of benign stewardship of the rest of nature. This can sound extraordinarily futuristic and utopian, but it's worth recalling that by the middle of this century and beyond, every cubic meter of the planet is going to be computationally accessible to surveillance, micromanagement and control. So we have to decide what forms of consciousness, what life forms we want to exist. Do we want to have creatures being eaten alive, parasitized, disemboweled, asphyxiated, all the stuff that is going on right now as I speak? Or do we want heaven on earth, paradise engineering? And all of what you enjoy about nature, appreciate nature, its beauty, its variety, even the same or recognizable approximations of the same species can live and flourish in our wildlife parks, but without the nasty stuff. And to someone who is, let's say, a species essentialist who claims that a lion that isn't killing or asphyxiating zebras or killing the cubs of the lioness whose partner he has just killed or driven out, that is not truly a lion. I would simply say, well, are Homo sapiens truly Homo sapiens because we now wear clothes and for the most part don't beat each other over the head? Yeah, we are a recognisable approximation of our Stone Age ancestors, but hopefully rather more civilised. And likewise, it's possible to civilise the rest of the living world too. It's worth distinguishing between being wild and free living, in that this, I'm not making the case for turning everything into a zoo in which non-human animals are prisoners, but nonetheless, in future, if we do live in a civilized ecosystem with compassionate stewardship of nature, there won't be today's horrors. Costing, to do, for instance, a welfare state for elephants, cradle to the grave, free living African elephants, might cost perhaps $2 to $3 billion a year. One would need to provide everything from immunocontraception, obstetric care. Free living adult elephants generally lead pretty healthy lives so long as there isn't hunger, but in late life an elephant will die when the final set of molars wears down, the elephant is unable to feed properly, will grow weaker and will eventually collapse and perhaps be eaten alive by predators or something ghastly like that. Whereas interventions, for example, late life orthodontic care, one could fix a new set of molars and the elephant could live quite happily. As I said, that's just one species. If we were to extend this kind of care to other large living vertebrates and beyond. This would cost more money, and as long as there are people who are starving, malnourished, most people would say that yeah, people come first. Once one has provided for a basic level of care for human animals, one can do the same for non-human animals too, and the cost will come progressively down. Well, there are certainly scientific grounds for cataloguing and understanding nature as it exists at present, but conservation biology as it exists at present is an explicitly normative discipline, which is perhaps quite unusual in science. Scientists often pride themselves on being value neutral and say one shouldn't make value judgments, which of course itself involves an element of paradox, but conservation biology, this idea that we should try to preserve nature, or rather an idealized conception of what we think of as nature, as it has traditionally been. And the perspective I'm arguing for is intermediate between the idea that one should effectively phase out nature because it is just so horrible, and a traditional view that doesn't pay attention to the subjective well-being of other living organisms. There's this ethic that conservation biologists often invoke, that one shouldn't interfere with nature. In practice, it's not an ethic that they adhere to strictly. You'll find such phenomena as rewilding, captive breeding programs for big cats and so on. So in practice, we are interfering with nature all the time, frequently by way of uncontrolled habitat destruction. But even conservation biologists themselves involved in programs for intervention. But the kind of ethical biology, compassionate conservation that I'm arguing for essentially involves benign stewardship of nature. And here's an analogy. Last century, it was quite common to hear the argument that if famine broke out in sub-Saharan Africa, for example, that one shouldn't provide food famine relief because all it would do in the long run would lead to more suffering, just a further population explosion and ecological collapse. We now, for the most part, I think, recognize that the ethical thing to do is to provide, yes, both emergency care, health provision, food, but also family planning, so that prospective parents can regulate the size of their families. But exactly the same principles are possible with non-human animals too. That sure, yes, if there is a famine and elephants are starving, that one provides emergency food relief, but this clearly isn't a long-term solution. One has to regulate population numbers. Now, traditionally, any form of compassionate intervention in nature would, it's true, probably do more harm than good. Feeding starving herbivores in winter, for example, in temperate climes, all that would do, yes, short-term relief, but there would then be a population explosion, mass hunger, starvation. One wouldn't have done any good at all. What is different today is that with existing technologies or very easily, readily recognizable extensions of existing technologies, one can have cross-species fertility regulation, basic healthcare provision, and extend the principles of the welfare state to other species. Initially, presumably, in our wildlife parks, this would be large, long-lived vertebrates, but a future civilization, next century and beyond, could do the same for much smaller organisms too. What do we actually want to preserve? Should we try and preserve each species, each 800,000 species of beetle? Perhaps that's not realistic. At the moment, there's every time one cuts down a tropical tree in some areas of the world, one probably wipes out a species of beetle. But what will be possible to do, if we consider it ethically desirable, is to preserve the well-known species of vertebrate. How far, inverted commas, down the phylogenetic tree one wants to go is clearly up for debate. But this perspective that one can phase out, that we can, as a society, as a civilization, choose to phase out involuntary suffering in nature, it would need to be done by consensus. But just as in zoos today, it's generally regarded as wholly unacceptable, quite rightly so, to feed live rodents to snakes, exactly the same principles are going to be involved in tomorrow's wildlife parks. Exactly the same complicity will be involved. As if, and this is just an example, imagine if you stumbled across a shallow pond and a toddler was drowning. If you didn't pull the child out, it would be almost as bad as if you'd pushed the child in yourself. But the same level of complicity in the suffering of other sentient beings is going to be involved across planet Earth. This is the global village phenomenon, that such is the nature of information technology that the entire planet essentially is going to be computationally, robotically accessible to this kind of micromanagement.